Make sure to subscribe and turn on the notifications so you can be alerted when new content is released. Enjoy the video.
Your brain, first of all, is the consistency of a soft-boiled egg. It's 78% water. It's like soft butter. Mm-hmm. And it's so much water, and the water actually facilitates electrical charges. So then, as you interact with your environment, when you think differently, when you make a different choice, when you behave differently, when you have a new experience, when you feel differently, they have biological effects that causes those neurons to literally repattern themselves. So you learn something new. Nobel Prize laureate Kandel in the year 2000 found that when people learned one bit of information, they doubled the number of connections in their brain from 1,300 connections to 2,600 connections. But here's the key. If they didn't review that information, if they didn't revisit it, if they didn't rehearse it in their mind, those circuits were pruned apart within hours or days. So if learning is making new synaptic connections, then remembering is maintaining and sustaining those connections. So what's the ingredient that causes mm-hmm. those neurons to stick more? Mm-hmm. Attention is one of them.
Repetition.
And repetition is the other. And so when a person begins to repeat something like a phone number or a line in a song, or they're meeting someone for the first time and they have to pay attention to their name, if they're not present and they're not paying attention, of course, those circuits never actually glue together. But if the person produces an emotional response where you shake their hand and they give you a hug and a kiss and they say, I know your mother because I went to school with her.
Oh, yes.
And the moment you see this person and you feel differently inside of you, the moment you feel differently inside of you, you're going to pay attention more to whatever's causing it outside of you. And that in and of that event in and of itself is called a memory. So the more highly charged emotional experiences we have that take us out of our resting state causes us to pay attention more to our external environment. I mean, think of 9/11. Every single American in the United States can tell you exactly where they were, who they were with, and what they were doing that time of day if mm-hmm. they were awake. Mm-hmm. And we could say that everything that they were seeing and hearing changed their internal state.
True.
The moment they felt differently, they woke up and they looked to see what caused it, and it was that event. So then they look around them and they correlate their changes with everything in that moment. So then the key then is if we are going to truly make long-standing connections in our brain, the more passionate we are, the more we can feel deeply, the more that we can assign meaning to what we're doing in the midst of that elevated emotion, it's going to cause us to come out of our resting state, and the internal experience that we're having becomes a long-term memory. And now it's the deal is sealed. You can have 10 great things happen to you in one day. You can have one bad thing happen.
What is up with
and
that?
You will always remember the one bad thing, and you'll forget the 10 good things. And the reason being is because we're programmed for survival. In survival, the one bad thing that happens, you got to pay attention to, because you're going to have to anticipate, if it happens again, how you're going to deal with it.
True.
So we put a lot of our attention on those survival things, and we're wired for survival. So then in order to truly make substantial changes, not by forcing an outcome or controlling an outcome or, you know, overly analyzing an outcome, but to really change it in the new model of science with a clear intention and elevated emotion, I think we have to lay down the very thing we used our whole life to get what we want for something greater to occur. And that's really easy to talk about, and it's a little more difficult to do. The ultimate truth is oneness. That everything else is a diminishing of that. So if you understand biologically where oneness occurs, it occurs right here in the heart center. And what if you took 10 minutes out of your day, 15 minutes out of your day, to rest your attention in that center? Where you place your attention is where you place your energy. To cultivate an elevated emotion like gratitude, or joy, or the joy for existence, or the love of life, or compassion. And you felt it deeply. Do you know that the moment energy moves into your heart, the field around your body expands to 9 meters wide? When you're living in survival and you're living in fear and anxiety and anger and hostility and violence and sadness and guilt, you're drawing from this invisible field and you're turning it into chemistry. And the field around your body shrinks. Now you're more matter and less energy. You're more particle and less wave. And you don't have any energy to actually for long-term building projects like growth and repair or to create anything you want in your life. Turns out, that the heart has a magnetic field. So it's like dropping a pebble in the water. And if you can sustain that emotional state, now you are dropping pebble after pebble and it's sending ripples out. The more profound you feel, the more passionate, the more enriched you feel, the bigger the stone you're dropping in the water, the bigger the wave. Now, all frequency, all energy carries information. So that's the magnetic charge. So what is the information? It's the intention. It's the mind know. So then you then send an intention on that wave. You have a clear intention, and that information is being carried on that frequency wave. Now you're broadcasting an electromagnetic signature into the field. And so then when you're living in survival, you're always trying to control the outcome, force the outcome, predict the outcome. And when you do that, you're in your own way because you're matter trying to influence matter, and it's going to take a certain amount of time. We call that three-dimensional creation. Fifth-dimensional creation is the opposite. You're actually not going anywhere. You are the vortex that's calling the experience to you. So then when you combine that clear intention with an elevated emotion, when there's a vibrational match between your energy and that potential in the quantum field, it's like taking a tuning fork and hitting the tuning fork, and you have another one, and that one is going to produce the same harmonic. Now there's a vibrational match. And the longer you can sustain that energy, or better yet, the faster the frequency, the more elevated the emotion, the faster in time it happens. And teach people how to do that properly. They would never try to control the outcome. They trust in the outcome because this is the center where you trust the unknown. So now you're laying down the very thing that you've done because you don't feel separate from possibility. You're not a materialist defining reality with your senses, which occurs primarily from the hormones of stress. Actually, the opposite is happening. Your heart is open and you feel connected to something greater. And
And
it's
then
none of your business on when it's going to happen or how it's going to happen. Because if you can predict when it's going to happen and how it's going to happen, it's not an unknown.
back
It's
to
a known.
matter.
Ten minutes of gratitude a day releases a chemical called immunoglobulin A, the primary defense against bacteria and viruses. 10 minutes of anger or impatience or frustration or fear turns on 1,200 different chemicals that causes the body to mobilize energy and suppresses the immune system. So then,
In 10 minutes.
in 10 minutes. So then the person who's feeling gratitude and those elevated emotions in the morning, and you check their blood values of IgA, immunoglobulin A, at the end of the day, it's still elevated. In other words, it lasts, you just took the shot. You took the flu shot, and it's going to protect you against bacteria and viruses. Now, here's the truth. Germs don't make you sick. We make ourselves sick. And if you're in a company where everybody's getting infected and they're all sick at the same time, it's not the bug. It's they're all stressed and they're all
So,
susceptible. They're called opportunistic bacteria because they're waiting for an opportunity to proliferate if your immune system is compromised.
no,
So
it's
people need to
mean.
know the truth about this because they're programmed into believing that germs make them sick. So
Yes,
there's no germ out there with your name on it that's waiting to attack you. We have just as many microorganisms in our body as we have cells. So it's just the way in which we manage our internal states. You learn a bit of information. That information actually causes neurons to assemble into new connections. That's what learning is. We said that. And it's stored in your thinking, theoretical, philosophical, analytical neocortex. If you take that information and you get your body involved and you apply it and you personalize it or you demonstrate it, it means you have to modify your behaviors in some way and do something differently and initiate that knowledge. And if you do it properly, you have a new experience. The experience then enriches the circuits in your brain that you understood philosophically. But then another part of the brain called the chemical brain or the emotional brain or the limbic brain makes a chemical for you to feel differently. So the moment you feel compassion or the moment you feel like a patient parent or the moment you feel like a great leader because you read the book on any one of those things, the moment you feel that emotion, you're teaching your body chemically to understand what your mind is intellectually understood. So we could say knowledge is for the mind and experiences for the body. And in that moment, you are embodying knowledge. The word is becoming flesh, and you're signaling new genes in new ways because it's a new experience, and that the chemical reaction from the environment is selecting new genes. If you're able to reproduce that experience over and over again, the process of re-experiencing it is neurologically and chemically conditioning your brain and body to work together as one mind. Or if you've done something so many times, your body knows how to do it as well as your mind.
Right.
Now you're in a state of being. Now it's innate in you. It's who you are.
Mm-hmm.
You've done it so many times, you don't have to think about it. It's almost subconscious. So our job then is to go from philosopher to initiate to master. From thinking to doing to being. From mind to body to soul. From knowledge to experience to wisdom. And we all have all the biological and neurological machinery to do that. So the problem I think that we have in our life is we reach a certain point where we stop evolving into that state of being, and we get caught up in subconscious beliefs and perceptions about the way we think reality is based on how we've had so many experiences in our life. So then people make up things about reality because of their past experiences, and all beliefs are subconscious states of being. We have people in our work that have healed themselves of very serious health conditions that have taken 4 years or 3 years to do it because it took them 5 years to create the condition because of a stressed out lifestyle and poor choices. And they understand that in order to turn the battleship around, you know, even placebo studies sometimes are 6 or 8 weeks long. The depression studies, the person's taking a placebo for 6 or 8 weeks to remind themselves of a new state of being. So you don't need the sugar pill or the saline injection to move into a new state of being. You can combine a clear intention with an elevated emotion and change your very physiology. But you're knocking on the genetic door, and it may take a little bit of time to continuously knock on that door before you program the gene. Other people are able to do it in a very short amount of time. So the key is that we just have to be persistent with it, and we start to see some changes.